Luke chapter 1. Glory to God. Luke chapter 1, and we're going to read verse 37. I'd like for you to read it with me. Ready? Read. For with God, nothing shall be impossible. That's good news right there. With God, nothing. I don't know what you need right now, but I can tell you nothing shall be impossible. Today we're continuing the series that we began last week entitled Refresh. And of course, as I mentioned to you last week, many of us have had the experience of getting on the internet, pulling up a website, and the page not loading correctly. And so we have to find the refresh icon or button, whatever you want to call it. And when we hit that button, then it loads again, and it loads correctly. And for many of us, if not all of us, there have been areas of our life where things haven't loaded correctly, where things don't look like we really wanted them to look. They don't look like we planned for them to look. There are areas in our lives where, frankly, it looks like we've lost. That, you know, it is too late, and we might as well just move on and try to make the most of whatever we have left. But we learned that last week that with God, it's never too late. In fact, we looked at a number of people in the Word of God who were in similar situations, and we found, you know, people like Abram, who him and his wife had a child when he was 100 and she was 90. It wasn't too late for them. We found how Jacob and Esau, two brothers who literally were at war at one time because Esau planned to kill Jacob, yet God restored them. It wasn't too late for them. We found a single woman by the name of Ruth who was a widow and a little older than the competition, but it wasn't too late for her, and God gave her a mighty man of wealth by the name of Boaz. We found that in Daniel chapter 3, there were three Hebrew boys who were thrown into a fiery furnace. I mean, it would seem that they are dead and it's too late, but it wasn't too late. Jesus showed up in the furnace with them and brought them out, and it was like they had never went in. We looked at a woman in Mark chapter 5 who had had the same illness for 12 years, and yet she found out about Jesus, pressed in to receive from him, and God healed her. It wasn't too late for her. We found out about a man named Lazarus in John chapter 11 who was actually dead for 4 days, but it wasn't too late for him. God raised him up and used his life to make Jesus famous. And then we ended with, you know, a man by the name of Peter, and mentioned some others who frankly had failed God, who had, you know, really denied Jesus. And yet it wasn't too late for him. Jesus accepted him home and still used him to do what he planned for him to do all along. And if you've gotten away from God, it's not too late for you. God will welcome you home as well and give you the amazing future he has planned for you as well. Well, go with me, if you will, to Isaiah chapter 43. The whole goal of this series is to get you to press the refresh button. To believe again that God can work this out. God can make it right. God can still give you the amazing future he has planned for you. Well, Isaiah chapter 43. And if I were to give a separate title to this message today, it would be this. It's time for your comeback. It's time for your comeback. In fact, turn to neighbor and tell them that. Tell them it's time for your comeback. Turn to somebody else and tell them it's time for your comeback. Find somebody else and tell them it's time for my comeback. Yeah, it's time for your comeback. I'm going to say it again. It's time for your comeback. I remember a number of years ago, going to, and this had to be over a decade ago, going to a Lions game back when they were in the Silverdome. And the Lions were getting beat really bad by the Minnesota Vikings. And it was the fourth quarter, and they were down, I think, either 21 points or 28 points. And, you know, you were within the fourth quarter. So you had like, I don't know, maybe 12 minutes to go, 10 minutes, something like that. And they scored a touchdown. Got an onside kick, which means they got the ball back, scored another touchdown. Play start, you know, everybody start getting a little excited. Got a stop, scored another touchdown. Now the place is going crazy. Got another stop, scored another touchdown, and won the game. And, you know, we saw actually some of that this year with the Detroit Lions. We saw them have a number of games where, you know, they were down, you know, deep into the game, and yet they came back. In fact, it got to the place where if you were a Lions fan and it was near the end of the season, and, you know, we were down by 21 in the fourth quarter, we'd say we got them right where we want them, right? Because we knew we were coming back. And the players started to act like that and think that way. I mean, they developed the confidence in themselves to such a degree that they felt like it didn't matter how far they were down, that it was not too far, that they could come back. Now, if athletes can feel that way, based on their understanding of their ability individually and collectively, and yet you have on your side the one we just finished singing about, the one nobody is greater than, the one to whom nothing is impossible, then no matter how far down you may be, no matter how out of it you may seem to be, I'm here to tell you, God's a God who can bring you back. And hey, it's time for your comeback. So let's look at Isaiah 43 and see if we can find some scriptures that approve that for us. Verse 18, and actually in this opening of scripture, God's actually talking to Israel about their comeback. He's saying it's comeback time. He's telling them what he's going to do for them. He says, remember ye not the former things. Of course, the word remember here simply means to think about, to call to remembrance. He said, don't remember those former things or those past things. Don't remember those things that happened in the past. Neither consider the things of old. And the word consider here means give attention to. So don't give any attention to those ancient things. Behold, I will. Now notice in verse 18, he's talking about the past. In verse 19, he starts talking about the future. In fact, in a moment, we're going to find out he's talking about the present. I will do a new thing. Somebody say new thing. Now, one of the things you can see by how he's phrased this is that this new thing is something that is new to them. It's something they never experienced in their past. It's something that they've not seen, they've not enjoyed yet. But God's saying, I'm going to do a new thing for you. When? Now. Now you might say, well, Pastor, that's great for them, but, you know, that doesn't apply to us. Well, actually, one of the things that we heard the Spirit of God say on New Year's Eve, and he didn't just say it here, he said it all across the nation, was that this was a year of great opportunity, that this was a year of breakthrough. This was a year of suddenly. This was a year where the things we believed God for, in some cases for years, would actually come to pass. This is our now season. This is our now time, which is why I can say boldly to you, it's time for your comeback. Because some of us, we've been behind and we need God to catch us up. Well, now is the time. He says, now it shall spring forth. Notice that phrase, spring forth. If you look it up, it means to sprout or to bud. Well, when you think about something that would sprout or bud, like, you know, a plant or even a tree or whatever, things along those lines. Well, you know that the way this works is that you sow a seed, and then that seed requires time. I mean, frankly, a seed grows down before it grows up, right? So a seed requires time. Time has to pass. But after time has passed, at some point, that seed will start to break through the ground. In fact, you could walk past that wherever you planted that seed on Monday and see nothing. And come back on Tuesday and see the ground broken up and something sprouting up. Well, God's saying here, I'm going to cause this new thing to spring forth. In other words, I'm going to cause a breakthrough. And we know, frankly, that many of us, we sowed seeds. in the past, not just financially, but in other areas of our lives, and we've been waiting for some time, and really our suddenlies aren't that sudden. We knew they were coming. It's just that you didn't know what day it was coming, but God says, now it shall spring forth. Now you'll have your breakthrough. Now you'll have your suddenly. Now you'll have that quick, explosive move of God that'll produce what you were believing for. I'm preaching better than y'all saying amen in this place. Say, now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? Oh. He's not talking about you having a breakthrough where you almost, you know, where you kind of, you know, is that God? He's not talking about you getting to the end of 2012 and, well, it was a, I think God moved. It was a good year, I think. He's talking about that by the time he gets done with your breakthrough, with your suddenly, with those opportunities, you're going to know it. You will know it. You will know it. God did this. The only way it ever could happen is if God did it, and God did it, and my neighbor knows it, my family knows it, my colleagues know it. The Lord came through. So you'll know it. What kind of breakthroughs are we talking about? What kind of new things is he talking about producing for us? I will even make a way in the wilderness. Now, we know what the wilderness is. It isn't that little patch of grass between one apartment complex and another that you find in Detroit. When the Bible talks about the wilderness, it's talking about the wilderness. Okay? Lions and tigers and bears, oh my. It's hard to walk through the wilderness. But God says, I will make a road, because that's what the word way means, in the wilderness. Now, I remember when Word of Faith was very young. I still remember like it was yesterday. And we were on 10 Mile in Ferndale. And my parents and I, and at that time, it was just my Pastor Michelle, Minister Christina, wasn't here yet. That's when she came. But they actually lived in a parsonage next to the church. So I still remember, you know, we had a little parking lot, a little basketball rim out there. I'd go out and play in a little basketball rim, you know. And I remember that in front of the church, 696 was being constructed. You know, it's just one thing. It was a part of my life. You know, you look out there and you see, you know, the individuals out there, you know, they're building this up. You see all the equipment. And it took years before, you know, it was done. But God is talking about creating your own 696 and your own wilderness. And it doesn't take God years. Come on, he's the one that said light be and light was for the whole universe. He's saying, I'm going to make a road in your wilderness. Even where it's difficult and right now, I will make a road through it, and it'll be easy for you to walk through this valley of the shadow of death. It'll be easy for you to walk through and get where I want you to get to. And notice this, and rivers in the desert. Oh, man, what makes the desert? The desert is that there's no water. But can you imagine a river in the desert? I mean, a river is a lot of water. And God said, I'll make not just a river, but rivers in the desert. So you got one river running through, another river running through, another river running. In other words, a desert turns into a Garden of Eden. And God's saying, whatever your desert is, I'm about to make rivers in that desert. I'm not going to give you a little drop here and a little drop there so you can survive while you're trudging through life. I'm going to drop a river in that desert, and then I'm going to drop another river in that desert, and then I'm going to drop another river in that desert. I will make your dry places moist and prosperous. He said, when is he going to do it? Now it will spring forth. Now you'll have a road. Now you'll have rivers. And you ought to believe God for rivers in this economic desert. Yeah, things may be rough, but not for me, not in my house. God's blessing me. God's prospering me. God's going to do it this year because he said he would. It's my time. It's time for my comeback. I'm going to be able to do what I want with my house. It's not underwater anymore. Its value is escalating. I'm getting out of debt. My needs are being met. I'm having a full store to spread the word more. It's time for my comeback. Hallelujah. This is not the time to put your head down and go, oh me, oh my, how did I get here? Listen, we understand how we got there. We've talked about it. Now it's time to say, well, I got here, but God's not leaving me here. Yeah, this happened, but that's not the end of my life. I'm going to remember the comma in my life. I'm getting rid of that period. I'm adding a little something to that period and saying, yeah, I was down, but God brought me back. Yeah, I was out, but God brought me in. Yeah, it wasn't working out, but God made it work out. It was the greatest comeback of my life. It's time right now, right now, right now, right now, right now. You need to get excited about it. Yeah, it's comeback time. Woo! This is gonna be awesome. That's part of believing again. Saying, yeah, I believe the word. Now it will spring forth. I may not get home before God does what he said he's gonna do. See, faith people aren't sad and mad and disgusted. We believe God. That's why we're full of joy. That's why we can praise God and say nobody greater than you, because we know who we serve and we know nothing is impossible to him. It's time for your comeback. Glory to God. So let's talk about, let me give you four keys to your comeback. So go with me, if you would, to Mark chapter 11. Now it will spring forth. You ought to have some expectancy this year. And you know, one of the things that the enemy does is when the word of God comes forth, he comes for the word's sake. So what that means is that, you know, you hear a good word like what we heard New Year's Eve or even what we're talking about today. We see what God says about it. And Satan can see you get excited about it and believing it, which means it's going to happen unless he does something about your belief, your faith. So he sends trouble your way or people your way. So you'll get offended. So Mark chapter 4 talks about. One of the four plays in this playbook, or three plays in this playbook. And if you'll get offended, then all of a sudden it won't happen for you. That's part of what we heard on New Year's Eve when Bishop ministered, and you know, Brother Copeland's ministered along these lines and others, that you know the good is going to come. The question is, will you see the good? And that's gonna depend on whether or not you were looking at the right thing. And what happens is Satan sends trouble your way, so you get to looking at the wrong thing. All he's trying to do is get you distracted, to get you to stop focusing on what God said to you and start focusing on what you happen to be seeing or experiencing in your life or through somebody attacking your life. So I can imagine that some of us, I asked this in the first service, but I can imagine some of us have had a rough start to the year. But anybody say that's been going on with you? You know, some of us, we've had a rough start to the year. And it's not because what God said isn't true. It's simply because the enemy's attacking. But I want you to realize that he cannot stop what God has said he's going to do in your life. That's why he attacks your faith. See, he knows he can't stop what the word will produce. So the only thing he can do is try to stop you from believing and receiving it. But if you will not give in to that, if you'll say, you know what, I don't care what I see, I don't care how I feel. I don't care if the whole world comes against me. I believe God. And I'm going to cooperate with God. You will have everything God said. You will see it's never too late. You will enjoy your comeback. You will enjoy great opportunities and breakthroughs and suddenlies. So don't let the devil trick you. You need to tell the devil deuces. Give him your deuces, faith. Deuces, get out of here. Come on, Mark chapter 11. Four keys to your comeback, because we do have a role to play in this. And that's part of what we were just talking about. So first one is here in Mark chapter 11, verse 25. It says, and when you stand, in fact, let me back up to verse 24. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, when you pray, believe that you receive them and ye shall have them. Clearly, that's part of how God's going to do what he's going to do in our lives. We're going to ask God in faith, and God will give us what we ask for. But notice what goes along with this. Verse 25 begins with the word and. So the thought is not complete. And when ye stand praying, when you are praying about what? Father, bless me with this. Father, do that for me. Whatever it is you're praying for. In the middle of that prayer time, there's something else you got to do. Forgive. I'm glad I got the shouting out the way. About to get back behind the pulpit. No, just kidding. When you stand praying, forgive. Now, what's implied just in how that's spoken, how that's said, and as we'll continue to read this scripture, we'll see that this is true, is that if you don't forgive, you won't receive. So he says, when you stand praying, forgive if you have aught against any. Well, the word forgive here means a couple of things. It means to send forth, to let go, and to yield up. So really, it just means to let it go. Some other, you know, dictionaries just simply define it as to pardon. We're familiar with what happens when a governor pardons a criminal. It's not that the governor's saying that they didn't commit the crime. The governor is saying it's forgiven. You don't have to pay the price for that crime. And the reason why Jesus had to say this, the Bible talks so much about forgiving others, is because he knows that anytime you deal with people, people will do you wrong. In fact, in this particular scripture, in verse 25, ends with the word trespasses. And trespasses are two different types of things that people do to you. Unintentional errors. In other words, they did you wrong, but they didn't really mean to. But it still hurt. Or willful transgressions. In other words, they did you wrong and they meant to. They were trying to hurt you. And he's telling us here that we have to let it go. We got to forgive them. We got to pardon them. We got to say, you know what? I know what you did. It was wrong, but I forgive you. I'm going to treat you like it never happened. I'm not trying to get vengeance on you. I'm not trying to punish you the rest of your life. By not giving you the pleasure of my presence. Well, now, he's saying we have to forgive them. And I won't take it there for time's sake, but in Matthew 18, Peter asked Jesus the question. He says, how many times should I forgive my brother for the same thing? Till seven times? That's a lot. Most of us wouldn't make it to seven times. Come on. If somebody did something to you and you forgave them and they came and did the exact same thing to you again, and let's just say you forgave them by the power of God, and then they came back the third time and did the same thing to you again. Come on now. So Peter thinks he's being spiritual. He says, till seven times. You know, he is talking to Jesus, right? So you got to try to sound like you're spiritual, right? Jesus says, till seven times 70. And of course, he wasn't saying count to 490 and then kill him at 491. And then he told a story about a man who owed a king really millions of dollars of debt. And he was brought before the king, and the king is saying, you know, I'm going to have you and your family, you know, sold into slavery, and you're going to work off this debt. And he begs the king. He says, you know, please don't do that. Give me time, and I'll pay it off. And the king has compassion on him and says, you know what? I'm forgiving you of the whole debt. I mean, what a blessing, right? This guy leaves. He runs into a guy on the street that owes him the equivalent of about $20. Finds the guy, says, hey, man, where's my $20? He says, I don't have it yet, man. He says, you know, man, where's my $20? You know, getting the guy says, just give me some time. I'll give it to you. And instead of forgiving this guy the debt or even giving him time, he has him thrown in prison. Well, the king finds out about it, brings the guy back and basically says, I forgave you of your debt, but you couldn't forgive that man of that debt. I'm throwing you in prison. And then Jesus says, this is how God views when we won't forgive others of what they've done to us. mean, you think about it, we've done millions of dollars worth of things wrong to God. And whatever somebody's done to us, it doesn't compare. And if God has forgiven us, anybody glad God's forgiven us? Then we ought to forgive each other. But he ends that by talking about forgiving from the heart. And so we're talking about making a heart decision that I forgive you. I'm pardoning you. As far as I'm concerned, I've let it go. And it gets a little trickier here in verse 25 because he says, when you stand praying, forgive, if you have aught against any. In fact, in my Bible, I wrote it so that it's any oughts against any anys. The word ought means a grievance. You know, so you got a grievance. I believe you did me wrong. Against anybody, you're to forgive them. And that's an issue for many of us because we kind of got two categories when it comes to this. We got those people who did those things that we didn't like, but you know what? We can forgive them for that. You know, it might take a little bit, but we can let it go. But then we got a second category of those people that did terrible things to us. Sometimes it's so terrible as they raped us, left us when we were kids, you know, daddy just left, abused us, you know, all kinds of things. And frankly, we have no plans to ever forgive those people. But Jesus is showing us that if you want to receive from him, you must forgive those people from your heart. Any ought against any person is unacceptable to God. It holds him back from being able to refresh your life. You could press the refresh button all you want. It won't do anything until you get this right. That's why the first key to your comeback is you have to deal properly with the past. You have to deal properly. There's a proper way to deal with the past, and there's an improper way to deal with the past. And the improper way is to live in the past, to bring it into your future. You know, we've all heard, you know, something along these lines about why your car is designed the way it is. Your windshield, your front windshield is this, you know, massive entity, and your rear view mirrors are relatively smaller. Why? Because you're supposed to peek in your rear view mirrors while you focus on what's in front of you. But if you spend all your time focusing on what's in the rear view mirror, you're going to end up crashing. And that's what happens in a lot of people's lives. Your life is not supposed to be defined by a terrible event that happened to you in your past. You shouldn't be known as the person who lost their child 10 years ago. Amen. It's a terrible thing. I'm not saying that things people have done to us aren't terrible things. But there's a way to deal with it. You shouldn't be known as the person that, you know, and this goes the other way too, though. You know, they was all state in high school 30 years ago. And they have done nothing in their life ever since then. Every time we talk to them, they want to talk about what they did in 1982. You know, part of the issue we have in the black community is that we're still caught up in the past. I mean, the civil rights movement was almost 50 years ago. And we still think like and make decisions and vote like somebody's going to bust in here and lynch every black person in the room. Oh, somebody getting mad at me now. Oh! Whatever happened in the past, good or bad, it should not determine your future. It should not cause you to limp into your future. You have to deal with it the right way. And then the first thing you got to do is you got to let it go. Go to Proverbs 28. You need God on your side for there to be a comeback, but for God to be on your side, he says you got to forgive him. Amen. Right now, you need to make a hard decision. You know what? I forgive him. That's it. I forgive him. That's it. It's over. I let it go. Now, don't worry. The devil going to try to bring it back. But you made your decision today. Amen. And that's it. So when he tries to bring it back, those feelings, nope, I rebuke that. I've already forgiven them. It's already gone. Amen. Proverbs 28. One more thing I mentioned to you while we're going to Proverbs. He ends up in Mark 11 saying, if you don't forgive your brethren, God won't be able to forgive you. And this is one case where God will follow your example. He's going to follow your lead. If you forgive, then he can forgive. If you don't, then he can't do what he wants to do in your life. Proverbs 28 and verse 13. Here's something else that helps us in regards to dealing with the past. He that covereth his sins shall not prosper, but whoso confesseth and forsaketh them shall have mercy. So if you've committed sin, you've done wrong, but you don't want to admit it, you won't prosper. There won't be any comeback. But if you'll confess those sins, and that's a big issue because sometimes we struggle to admit when we're wrong. We struggle to admit we're wrong to God. We surely struggle to admit we're wrong to others. And yet that's a key to healing. Being able to say, I'm wrong. Sometimes we go so far as to, you know, we know we did something wrong, so we go and do something else to make up for what we did without ever telling them we were wrong. And they had a nerve to be upset because they upset because what we did. Well, I did this for you. I didn't ask you about that. You just could have said, I was sorry. Now, you didn't even have to do all of that. You could have just said, oh, don't look at me like that. You know what I'm talking about. What keeps me from admitting I'm wrong? Pride. On Wednesdays, we've been talking about the character of a Christian, and we'll come back to that. We haven't got to this yet, but one of the things that I'm going to talk about is the fact that pride is one of the worst vices you could ever have. It may be the worst one. I mean, it will absolutely destroy your life. And here's one of the reasons why, because all of us will miss it from time to time. All of us will sin against God, not necessarily because we mean to, but we're still growing and developing. And when you miss it, when you misblown it in your past, the right way to deal with that is to go before God and ask for his forgiveness. Confess of your sin and do what the rest of the scripture says and forsake your sin. He that confesseth, it didn't say he that confesseth his sin shall have mercy. He that confesseth and forsakes. In other words, I'm not just saying I'm sorry and then go do it again. I'm sorry, go do it again. I'm sorry, go do it again. No, I confess it, I messed up, but now I'm leaving that in the past. I'm not doing that anymore. Then you get mercy, and with mercy comes blessing. 1 John 1:9, the scripture many of us are familiar with, it says if we as Christians confess our sins, then God's faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The Bible says as far as the east is from the west, he'll remove our sins from us. But it's if we confess our sins. There are things that we have done in the past that maybe some of us have not repented to God about. Some of us need to go find people. Because a lot of times when we talk about forgiveness, we think about how somebody did us wrong. But I can guarantee there's somebody you did wrong that's thinking about you. They might be in church thinking about you right now, sitting next to you. You know that's true with husbands and wives. She over there like, and he like. And they thinking about what each other. Sometimes you need to go and find them. Those are things that are necessary for you to go forward. Well, one last bit about that. Sometimes we need to forgive ourselves. You know, I mentioned this in the first service. I was sitting in the service during when the choir was singing. And I don't know why I thought about this. I thought about one aspect of my relationship with this one guy, and then I thought about this. And I was the pastor at a church in Georgia. This had to be, I don't know, almost 10 years ago. And this guy made a mistake. He had repeated a mistake. And I dealt with it the wrong way. And because I dealt with it the wrong way, he left the church. And I wasn't even upset he left the church because I was mad. Because he was wrong. If I told you what he did, he was wrong. But up until about the first service today, I felt like I dealt with that wrong, the right way. And then the Lord showed me that I didn't. And if I handled it right, if I did the right way, he probably wouldn't have left. And I right that moment, I said, Father, I repent of that. I didn't even realize I had done the wrong thing because I was thinking, well, biblically, I have no. I repent of that. And you have to have a soft heart. When you realize I did it wrong, yep, man. And then you have to learn how to forgive yourself. Because sometimes what we need to do with the deal with the past is we need to forgive ourselves for where we messed up in the past. Because if you've lived any time frame, you've made the kind of mistake that has had a domino effect in your life. It's impacted you. It's impacted people you cared about. It caused some real damage. Anybody would agree with that? Did you been through that? Yeah, and when that happens, and it takes years for God to fix it and all that stuff, man, it's very easy for you to get so down on yourself that you're almost good for nothing. And the devil will surely help you. He will remind you again and again and again and again and again what you did wrong and what happened because you did wrong. And the next time you got to make a big decision, he'll remind you how you blew the last decision. But you have no right to not forgive yourself. If God could forgive you, who are you not to forgive yourself? You need to let it go. Move on. You know, David had a son that died because of his mistake. You remember that story? He cheated on his man with that man's wife, Bathsheba. Had a baby. The baby died. God told him that's a result of his decision. And David prayed and cried to God while that child was alive. And when the child died, got up, cleaned himself off, cleaned himself up, went, sat down and ate. And his men said, what's going on here? When your child was sick, we couldn't get you to even eat. And now that the child is dead, you're just getting up and acting like nothing happened. And he says, I can't do anything about it now. He says, I will come to him again, but he won't come to me. He went ahead and cleaned himself up and moved on. He repented before God and moved on. You can't do anything about your mistakes. Amen. You can't, as much as we think about it, there is no time machine. Marty McFly is not showing up with a DeLorean. So you can go in the past and tell your younger self to not do this. And we all wish we could. I mean, come on. I sure had thoughts, Lord, if you just give me three times, just three, I could change my whole life. I mean, we've all had it, but it's not happening. It's just not going to happen. You just got to deal with the fact that you're human. You made a mistake. But then you also have to remember that, hey, because I've gone before God, God's washed away my sins. That I've never made a mistake that God can't fix. All right, go to Job chapter 22. So the first thing is you got to deal properly with your past. Job 22. Now, here in the book of Job, we have a young man who's speaking to Job, and he's under the impression that Job's gotten away from God, and he was partly right. But he's given him good advice, whether he was under the wrong impression or not. And what he says in verse 21 kind of helps us to get a hold of what we need to do as well to have our comeback. Somebody say, it's time for my comeback. Verse 21, acquaint now. Now, you want to now come back, you better do this now. Acquaint now thyself with him. With who? With God. Well, the word acquaint here means to become familiar with. It's translated elsewhere to treasure, and it's simply talking about walking with God. In other words, get back to God. Go back to walking with God. Praying before God. Do it now. And be at peace. That word peace, one of the ways it's translated is to make amends. I think that's accurate there. In other words, you know, some people, they're at war with God. You know, a lot of times because they're blaming God for something that happened in their life. And frankly, that's just the devil. That's just a trick of the devil. God's not your problem. He's your answer. God, good. Devil, evil. If evil happened in your life, it's because the devil did it. And some people, you need to make peace with God and realize that God's not the problem. And you know, one of the things that really bothers me, obviously I do a lot of posting online for, you know, because that's a great way to minister to people. But because I post things online, I get some responses from all kinds of people. And one of the things that I get every once in a while, I just think is really unintelligent, I'm trying to be very nice, is this idea of people, you know, trying to prove that God is evil. Well, God caused all the babies to do this. Didn't God do this? Didn't in the Bible? Didn't God do that? And I'm like, you know, what's the point of your argument? If God is evil, we in trouble. What you gonna do? You gonna boycott God? You're boycotting God into hell. You know what I'm saying? I'm gonna boycott God by going to hell. That doesn't make any sense. And then, of course, he isn't evil. Though you look throughout the entire world and you see everywhere good versus evil. why is it when it comes to spiritual things, we only think there's one person? It's been said many times, the greatest trick the devil ever pulled was to get the world to think he didn't exist. It bugs me when people want to blame God for stuff, and that's why they don't serve God, because God did this and God did that. And that's just not smart. First of all, he didn't do it. And second of all, even if he did do it, you still, if you had any brains, you still get on his side and then just ask him why he did it later. I mean, you gonna go to hell instead? I mean, anyway, I don't know if they got to do what I'm talking about. Anyway, make peace with him. That's what they had to do with it. Make peace with him. What happens when I start walking with God again? Thereby good shall come to thee. Somebody say, good is coming to me. Oh, that's a good confession right there. Good is coming to me. Why? Because you started walking with God again, became familiar with him, you know, prayer time. Verse 22, receive, which is the opposite of rejecting. No, receive, take it, accept it. I pray thee the law, his teachings, his instructions, his precepts from his mouth. So go ahead and get the word of God. Open your Bible and read what God says. You know, listen to the word in your car or watch it on TV, or especially come to church and get the word. But notice, if you do that, that's a great first step, but that is not going to get you where you want to get to unless you do the second thing he mentioned. And lay up, deposit, engrave, tattoo his words in your heart. So it's not good enough that I read a scripture, that I heard a message. What's going to cause me to have change in my life, what's going to bring about my comeback, is when I take the time, because it takes time to get a tattoo, right? When I take the time to engrave God's words in my heart so that they now abide in me. They're a part of me. They'll come out of me without me even really thinking about it. He's saying, go ahead and get in the word of God so that word is alive on the inside of you. If thou return to the Almighty, what does that mean to return to the Almighty? He just showed you when you start walking with God again, when you start implanting, engraving his words in your heart, then you return to him. That tells me if you're not walking with God, you don't have a daily prayer life, you're not putting that word in his heart, in your heart on a daily basis, then you're not as close to God as you think you are. You are not close to God like you should be. Now it's getting quiet in this place because I read about half your mail. But it's true. Isn't it very clear? Acquaint, receive, if you return. That's a part of walking with God. You know, there are five elements of the future God wants you to have, right? The first is walking with God. It's the most important one. What kind of Christian doesn't walk with God? Not much of one. We did a series last year called My So-Called Christian Life. Anybody remember that? We talked about the habits of a real Christian. Christian. I didn't say preacher. I said Christian. You know, Jesus is my Lord. Real Christians, read the Bible. Study it. Meditate on it. Not just at church. It's a part of their daily life. They pray. They get before God and spend time with God. And sometimes people say, well, I don't have time for that. That's a lie. There's nobody in this room that works 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Amen. You got time to do whatever you want. The issue is it's not a priority to you, which means your heart isn't as close to God as it should be. That's what that means. Something else is taking the place of God in your life. And see, when you hear you say that, people get upset. Well, you know, I know this word. I know that word. I'm full of the word of God. No. Spiritual growth isn't determined by how much scripture you know. Amen. How many Bible schools you went to. Amen. Or how long you've been saved, or what you did for Jesus in 1966. Because that's part of people's argument about church, you know. Listen, if you don't read your Bible, you don't pray, you don't go to church, you are a baby Christian. But I've been saved for 35 years. I went to this. You're a baby Christian. You're not even crawling yet. You're not even crawling. You're not even a toddler. But see, the way things work spiritually is not how it works naturally in the natural. You could go get a degree in engineering, and 20 years later, people will still give you credit for the fact that you had a degree in engineering, even if you don't remember anything from your degree in engineering. But you can still get a job and sit there and have an interview and say, I got a degree in engineering. But spiritually speaking, it didn't work like that. It's not what you did, it's what you're doing. We know where you are by your fruit, by your lifestyle. You know, I came across a tweet this week from a well-known minister, and he said something that I thought was really good. He talked about the fact that this idea that I don't need a church is nonsense. Because you can't love Christ and not the body, the king and not his kingdom, the father and not his family. You know, there's a lot of people, I don't need church. Church is full of hypocrites, and I don't like this and the way they do that. And well, you know, baby. It's called, it's being soft, being weak. See, something, you know, what we have to do, we have to stop being know-it-all, judge everybody, baby Christians, and go ahead and accept God's way. Grow up enough to do the basics of Christianity, the ABCs. It's quiet in this place. You know, a Christian that don't do these things, you know, it's kind of like a basketball player who never goes to practice. Right? It's like a student who doesn't go to school. Like a husband who doesn't go on dates with his wife. Like a construction worker doesn't bother to go get any supplies. I mean, think about this. If you have a marriage relationship where, you know, the husband and the wife have been estranged, and now they've decided to come back together. You know, okay, we're gonna get this right. But then he or she doesn't wholeheartedly pursue making this relationship work. You know, you don't ever spend time talking. Don't ever do anything nice for them. You know, just incredibly selfish. After they said, I want to make this work, that marriage is over. Amen. Right? I mean, they got a real problem. But we do that to God. You gotta ask yourself the question, am I really on fire for God? As far as God is concerned, I mean, really, God sees my heart. But if somebody who knew me didn't know anything about, you know, how long I've been saved and just start watching me today, if they were to watch me for the next month, would they come to the conclusion that I was on fire for God by what they saw me do? It's been said that you can tell where a person's heart is by looking at their checkbook. I didn't plan to go here, but I might as well go here. You know, you never tithe, you don't give offering, you do nothing. See, one of the things that Jesus talked about is you can't love God and money. So either money's going to be your God or God's going to be your God. But you never do what God's word says about your money. And as far as God is concerned, you're serving your money. It's a test for him. He doesn't give us tests to kind of make you sick and poor and disgusted, but he will test you. Amen. He will do like Jesus did in Mark 10 with that young ruler, and the man said, hey, what do I need to do to be saved? And Jesus said, you know, the Ten Commandments, and the guy said, I've done all of that. He said, there's one thing you're lacking. Take everything you have, give it to the poor, and follow me. Well, it wasn't that he was trying to make him poor. He went on and said later on, he'd have got 100-fold. But it was a money test for him. Some people are struggling in life because you just won't pass the money test. You've been at the same test every year for the last 10 years, and you can't figure out why you're still struggling. It's because money is your God. You can't give God 10 cents on a dime. At least you give the waiter 15%, but you can't give God 10 cents, 10%. I'm glad we shouted earlier. Are you really on fire for God? When God looks at your life, does he consider you a on fire Christian or a lukewarm Christian? Come on, you've been around things of God for a while. You know what you're supposed to be doing. And you know that excuses are just that. They're just excuses. And even when it comes to, well, I can't, people did this. This hurt me, that hurt me, this hurt me. I know God loves you. He didn't want those things to happen to you. But you don't go to church. You don't do these things because of other people. if every man of God on the planet walked away from God and backslid and got caught into every kind of sin you can imagine, and you was the only Christian yet left, you should still do right before God, because I do it for God, not for anybody else. And it's time we grow up and understand that. Stop being soft Christians. I call it soft because I'm a preacher's kid. I've seen a lot, been around a lot. I watch preacher's kids run away from God. And I understand why preacher's kids have run away from God, because of things that preacher's kids go through. But I've always considered those that do that soft, wimp, scrub, baby. No, I love you. But I think you get my point. Well, for some reason, we think with spiritual things, it's okay for us to be touchy. But if we're going to get on the football field, and we understand I got to be tough. Well, I'm sorry, baby. In life, you got to be tough. This is a war. This is more war than any football game you ever be on. You got to be tough. And you got to be tough not just for you, but for yours. For your wife, for your kids, for your family. They need you to tough it out and win this battle in your life so you can win them to Jesus and help them become disciples. I done preached away all my time. But my number two key is you got to totally sell out to God.
Amen.
You need to totally sell out to God. You got to consistently be in the presence of God to consistently receive from God. You read about those Hebrew boys in Daniel chapter 3, and they were going to be thrown in the fiery furnace. And what did they say? They said, God will deliver us, but even if he doesn't, we still aren't going to bow. That's a believer. Revelation 12 talks about believers in the last days, how we love not our lives to the death. If they were to take your life because you believed on Jesus, would you stand or would you fall? There are people like, and we read about pastor in Iran right now going through that. They keep taking him before court, trying to get him to denounce Jesus, with the price being they're going to kill him, and he refuses to do it. If that were you, would you do it? You know, if we were stuck in a jail cell somewhere in China, like some pastors. I know of a church that was one of the biggest churches in China. The government came in, raided it with their SWAT team, took the senior pastor and his wife, threw him in prison for 8 years for no reason, but preaching the gospel. If you were in prison for 8 years for the name of Jesus, I bet you'd be praying every day then. You'd be reading your Bible. You'd be singing praise and worship. You, anything to help me through this. Come on now. We all go through tough times. And when we get in tough times, we know what to do. But so what is it about prosperity that causes us to not walk as closely with God? At some point, that's part of growing spiritually. I remember there was a time when I first started ministry. I don't know if I've shared this publicly. When I first started preaching, I didn't have much of a prayer life. But what I would do is that if I knew I had to preach, I'd go pray. The day before and the day of, you rest assured, I was going pray so I could be anointed when I preached. Now, I was like, 20, 21. At some point, I realized that's not what a Christian, forget a preacher, that's not what a Christian's supposed to do. And I developed a prayer life, developed a word life, became a real believer. And that's the kind of church that this is. We're full of believers. We walk with God. Let me take it to two others real quickly now. Y'all still with me? Go with me, if you will, to John chapter 2. Only those who are fully and truly committed to God experience the miraculous on a consistent basis. It's time for your comeback. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Yeah, it is. It's right now. It's time. It's time. It's time. Go ahead and get your little rally towel going or whatever you do. Get your victory dance going. It's time. You got to do some things. Number three, John chapter 2 and verse 1. It says, in the third day there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. I believe she was the wedding coordinator. You'll see why in a minute. And both Jesus was called, and the word called means invited. So Jesus was invited and his disciples to the marriage. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, they have no wine. Jesus saith to her, woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. His mother saith to the servants. That's why I think she was a coordinator, because she could tell the servants what to do, right, in this setting. Whatsoever he saith to you, do it. Number three, whatever he says to you, do it. You want to come back? Whatever he says to you, do it. Whatever. Get that. Whatever. Because we like to give God parameters about what we're going to do. Well, God, you got to do it this way, or I only do this much. But she told them, knowing Jesus, whatever he says. He could have told them to go jump off a bridge as far as she knew. But whatever God says to you, do it. There can't be no off-limits areas with God. There can't be something that you won't. No. God, I will do anything you tell me to do. Notice she said whatever he says, not they said. So we're not talking about what your mama said, your husband said, your wife said, even your pastor said. No. Whatever he said. Only his word carries the power to produce miraculous. But realize whatever he said is an order. It's an order. He's giving you an order. And it's whatever he said to you. Not what he said to somebody else that they did and worked for them. I remember when I was in Bible school at Rhema, that when I was there, apparently, you had a couple in the church who, at that church, who the Lord told them to give away a car. And when they gave away a car, God blessed them with a better car. Somebody gave them a car. So they were apparently brought up before the church, told their testimony. So, you know, I'm at Rhema Bible Training Center, and frankly, Bible school students can be kind of special. Especially first-year Bible school students. Because they're so on fire for God, but they only know enough to be dangerous. A little flaky. I mean, I could tell you some stories. You know, you'd be prophet lying to you, you're trying to walk into class. And I had a cousin who went to school with me, and he just seemed to be a magnet for these kind of things. You know, but having said that, you know, they had the right heart. So what happened was, because of those people told their testimony about how God told them to give a car away, and they did it, and then God blessed them with a car, a number of students gave their car away and walked the whole year. I still remember watching them walk, thinking, my goodness, whatever he tells you to do. Now, first of all, he speaks to everybody through the word. But then he gives specific instructions about our individual lives through the Holy Spirit, which is one reason why you got to walk with God. Because if you spend time in prayer every day, then you'll be able to tell what God is saying to you. If you're asking, how do I know when I'm hearing from God? Then that tells me that you just aren't spending enough time in prayer yet. The more time you spend with God, the more you'll recognize his voice. He leads you by the inward witness. That's peace in your spirit. He leads by the inward voice. You don't hear that with the ears. You hear it in your heart. He leads by the voice of the Holy Ghost. That's a stronger voice, but it's still in your heart. And whenever he speaks to you about your life, then whatever he says, you need to do that. Don't get caught up on how God did it for somebody else. Now, God may show you some things. God may show you some things to help you learn a pattern he may use. But even then, it's still what he said. Amen. Whatever he says to you, do it. Now, the rest of the story is, I won't read it because of time's sake, but we know, well, maybe I should read it. Go ahead and look at verse 6. And there were set there 6 water pots of stone after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 firkins apiece. That's 120 to 180 gallons, some studies say. Jesus saith to them, fill the water pots with water, and they filled them up to the brim. Now, I'm sure they didn't understand why he said to do that. And sometimes God will tell you a first step and it makes no sense to you. Lord, I need wine. You just told me to fill this water pot with water. What's going on? But when God speaks to you, you have to be humble enough to just go ahead and do what he says. The Bible tells us to trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. That means that there are times God's going to tell you to do something that makes absolutely no sense to you, and you're going to have to be humble enough to just say, God, I trust you. And then you're going to have to be thorough enough to fill it to the brim.
Yes.
I don't understand it, God, but I'm a thoroughly obey you. I mentioned in the first service how some Christians, you know, we end up creating inferior products. We give inferior service. We have inferior businesses because we don't fill it to the brim. We're like, well, I got the blessing, so I only got to work half as hard. Well, the blessing was not designed to fill up the gap between your sloppy work and the unbeliever's great work. You're supposed to fill it to the brim. Give your best, be diligent, and then let God take your natural and put the super on your natural. But you can't be lazy and only half do what God tells you to do, but expect to have a great comeback. It doesn't work like that. He saith unto him, draw out now and bear unto the governor of the feast. Wait a minute, Jesus. Do we have to go to the governor? I mean, you think he'd say, draw out now and you know, sip it yourself and tell me if it's wine. Go find my mama and have her try it out, and then we're going to see what's going on. Now go to the governor, the one guy who could publicly embarrass us. And sometimes, many times, faith steps are big steps. There's going to come a point when it comes to your comeback where you're going to have to take a faith step, where God's going to say, jump, and you're going to have to say, how high? He's going to have to say, step out, and you're going to have to look down and see there's no bridge. And whatever he says to you, you need to do it. Last one, go to Genesis 18. I know I'm over time, but that's all right. It is vital that you are in the right place at the right time doing the right thing. Vital. There's a guy in 1 Kings 17. God wanted to feed him in a famine. Said, go by the brook Cherith. Ravens will feed you there. The problem for a lot of people is that it's not that God didn't send the ravens, it's that they aren't there. You need to make sure you're there where God tells you to be so that when God does open a door of opportunity, you can go through it. Number four, Genesis 18, verse 14. This is a very easy and simple one. It says, is anything too hard for the Lord? Is anything, any act, any miracle? He's talking to a 90-year-old woman about making a 91 woman pregnant. Is anything too hard for the Lord? Anything? Number four thing is you got to believe that nothing is too hard for God. I remember a number of years ago when I was moving from one home to another in Georgia, we had a couple of individuals from the church that was helping us, and we had one guy helping us, and this guy was huge. When I say huge, I mean his arms were about as big as my thighs, and I'm not exaggerating. I'm saying this guy was an absolute monster. Huge, okay? And I had some, you know, weights down in the basement, and I was a little smaller. Well, I was a lot smaller then, but still, my weights were, you know, good, appropriate for me where I was at. At the time. But I remember some of the guys that was with us, they were cracking up because he came and got those weights. You know, for me, it's, oh. He picked them things up. He just walking through the house, and they like, man, that's nothing for him, man. And I'm like, I can't stand you. You know what I mean? It was not too hard for him. Sometimes we look at our problems and we look at how they are hard for us. It's too hard for us. And we assume that means it's hard for God. But nothing is too hard for God. God can restore your marriage. God can bring your kid home. God can heal your body. God can get you out of debt. God can take care of you emotionally. God can do whatever is needed in your life, and he can do it easily. He stopped the sun. He created the sun. He gave you the ability to understand the sun. God can do what needs to be done. And you need to believe that and do get in the word of God until you believe that, so you can have what God wants you to have. Amen. Nothing is too hard for God. Pastor, it's easy to say believe it. How do I get there? Four things. You got to build your faith, which means like God did with Abraham. He had Abraham get the word. It was a word from God had for him. So shall your seed be. Got to have a scripture he'll have you stand on. Then take that scripture and do what Abraham did. God had him look up at the sky, see the stars, reminded him of what God said. Look at the ground, reminded him of what God said. So keep the word of God in front of you. You know, there's a scripture I got all over my house in little post-it notes because it's my scripture. God had Abraham speaking it. I'm Abraham, the father of many nations. He was saying it out of his mouth. You got to do the same thing. Keep saying that word out of your mouth. So keep, you know, God had Abraham reminded of the covenant. And I won't say how, but it worked. Every day he was reminded of the covenant. I will say, because God had him circumcised. Every day he's reminded. You know, you might need to take communion every day just to remember this is a covenant promise. But he was looking at the word. He was thinking about the word. He was speaking the word. You got to build your faith. And then at some point, you got to act in faith. You know, whether it's, you know, Paul telling a crippled man who heard the word and believed it to jump on his feet, and that's when he was healed. Or Moses lifting up the rod in front of the Red Sea and God parting the Red Sea. There's going to come a moment, as we said, where you're going to have to act on that. Then there's going to come a moment where, number three, you got to stand in faith. Faith and patience produce the promise. And patience is cheerful endurance. With faith comes hope, an expectation of a manifestation. So I'm going to walk around every day with expectation that today might be today. And then you got to praise in faith. Paul and Silas were in a prison in Acts 16. And what does the Bible say? They prayed and gave God praise. And that's when the prison doors opened. Israel walked around Jericho. And when they shouted, before the walls fell, the walls fell. You got to do what it takes so that you believe that nothing is too hard for God. I want to read one more to you. You don't have to go there if you don't want to. But Romans chapter 16, I think there's no better way to end this than this scripture. Romans 16. It's time for your comeback. Come on, Jesus was in hell. You remember that? Jesus went to hell. And before he went to hell, he said, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Remember that? I'm trusting you of my life. I believe you can get me out of hell. Then he died and went to hell. It looks like it's over. But he believed that God could get him out. And what happened? The power of God went down into hell, energized Jesus. He defeated Satan, took what he came for, rose from the dead. If God could raise Jesus from hell, God can sure refresh your life as well. Yeah, he can. Nothing's too hard for him. God can do it. It is time for your comeback, and you just got to believe God. If it wasn't too late for Jesus, it's not too late for you. Romans 16, verse 25. Let's end with this. Verse 20, I'm sorry. And the God of peace shall bruise, that word bruise doesn't just mean, you know, it means to crush, Satan under your feet shortly. Not one day when I get to heaven, shortly, any moment now, any day now. I'm going to say it again, any moment now, any day now. You may not get out of this church before you realize that, man, what's that on the bottom of my shoe? Oh, that's the devil. He was trying to mess with me. God finally used me to jump on his head. Glory to God. Yep, that's my comeback. I got it. Because that's the kind of God you serve. He's a God who will bring you a comeback in your life if you'll just cooperate with him. Amen. Go ahead, lift your hands toward heaven. Let's give God praise and glory. Thank you, Father, for being so good to us. We thank you that you are bringing forth comebacks for us. That right now you're working in our lives as we made the decision to forgive, if we've made the decision to sell out to you, as we made the decision to follow your direction, if we've chosen to believe that you can do anything, we thank you that you're moving right now. I thank you in this place right now that you're moving, that you're healing bodies, that you're giving wisdom. I thank you in our homes, you're moving right now, our financial situations, our jobs, that you're already moving right now. We ask that you do that. We thank you that is so in Jesus' name. We give you praise for it, Father. We give you praise for our breakthroughs. We do it ahead of time. We give you praise for our suddenlies. We thank you, Father, for it. We give you praise, Father, that you're making roads in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. We thank you that is already done. We thank you that this was the best year of our lives. We give you praise for it, Lord. We thank you that it's done. Our walls have fallen down. Our victory is already ours. We give you the praise and word and the glory for it because you're worthy of it. Because we believe you. We trust you. Glory to God. It's already worked out.